Okay, last week we started looking at what the New Testament has to say on the subject of homosexual conduct. And we began with Jesus' view of the matter. And we saw that the claim of some homosexual advocates that Jesus approves of homosexual conduct is patently false. First, I made the point that even if Jesus had made no reference whatsoever to homosexual conduct, his silence could not reasonably be construed as an endorsement of that behavior. And I then explained that he did, in fact, address the issue implicitly. He addressed it, homosexual conduct, implicitly in his condemnation of sexual immoralities, plural, and licentiousness or promiscuity, as the Christian Standard Bible translates it, in Mark 7 and the parallel in Matthew 15. In his acceptance in Matthew 19 and the parallel in Mark 10 of the model for marriage and sexual union that's presented in Genesis 1 and 2. In his presenting celibacy as the only option to heterosexual marriage in Matthew 19, 11 and 12. And in his general practice of deepening and intensifying the moral obligations of the law rather than abandoning them. As Robert Gagnon, New Testament scholar, summarizes the matter, he says, the portrayal of Jesus as a first century Palestinian Jew who was open to homosexual practice is simply ahistorical. All the evidence leads in the opposite direction. And then when we ended, we were looking at the Apostle Paul's condemnation of homosexual conduct in Romans chapter 1, verses 24 to 32. And there's the eye test, I promise, so you guys in the back can see if you can see that. Now, you'll recall that Paul states in the paragraph preceding this one, in Romans 1, 18 to 23, that God's wrath is now being manifested from heaven against the culpable suppression of the truth about him that he has made evident in creation. And in verses 24 through 32, Paul explains the form of that wrath, the divine reaction to this human rejection, this human suppression of his revelation in nature. And Paul says, as God hands them over. This is, as I said last week, this is a judicial act. Paul repeats that in verse 24, verse 26, verse 28. Handed them over. He handed them over. This judicial act, as God hands them over, we see the depths to which humanity sinks. Their lust finds expression in perverted sex exemplified by homosexual conduct. And Paul says that homosexuals receive in themselves the necessary penalty for their error, the sexual degradation they embrace. That sexual degradation in their rejection of God is punishment itself. It is part of God's judgment. And when the bell rang last week, I was pointing out how the sinfulness of homosexual conduct is here. It's rooted in the creation account. And I want to remind you of that, and then we'll move on. So you see here in verse 20 of Romans chapter 1, you see verse 20 speaks directly of God's creation. Paul says, since the creation of the world. In verse 25, you see God referred to as the Creator. Verses 26 and 27, they allude to the creation of mankind through the use of the adjectives male and female. Just as you have in the creation account, instead of using the nouns man and woman. So here you see verse 20, creation. 25, creator. 26 and 27, he uses the adjectives male and female as an allusion to the creation of mankind in Genesis. Homosexual conduct is contrary to nature in that it's contrary to God's design of mankind as male and female and his intention for their exclusive coupling. So these attempts that we're going to look at, these attempts to restrict what Paul is saying here, to exploitative or coercive forms of homosexual conduct, or to homosexual conduct that's committed in the context of idol worship, those attempts are groundless. But I'm going to have more to say about that. Because as I've said, what I've been trying to do, just to read the text and you say, okay, that looks pretty clear to me, I want to alert you to how people try to get around those texts. So we're going to talk a little bit about that in a minute. Now, denials to the contrary notwithstanding, Paul says and notes in verse 32 that humans know at some level that God is God and that He deserves the utmost honor. But despite that knowledge, they continue to rebel against Him and to approve of those who rebel against Him. They know what they do is wrong and that it deserves condemnation from God. You see that. Paul says that in verse 32. And this knowledge that they have is probably due both to the revelation of God in nature that He's talked about. His deity and His power are known from the things that He's made. But it's also probably due to what Paul calls in Romans chapter 2, verses 14 and 15, the law of the heart. The basic moral sense that is implanted within us by virtue of our being made in the image of God. So, you know, these denials notwithstanding, humans know. They know at some level, you see, that God is God and He deserves the utmost honor. And then in saying here in verse 32 that they not only do such wicked things, He says, but also approve of those who do such wicked things. So He said, look, they not only do them, but also approve of those who do them. And that suggests that Paul sees their approval of wrongdoing by others as even more culpable than the wrongdoing. Now that's trying to say, how is that possible? How is approving of wrong by others, how could that possibly be more culpable, more blameworthy than the actual wrongdoing? Well, let me give you a couple of suggestions from Charles Cranfield, C.E.B. Cranfield, in his commentary on Romans, where he says, the man who applauds and encourages others in doing what is wicked is, even if he never actually commits the same wicked deed himself, not only as guilty as those who do commit it, but very often more guilty than they. Well, how? He says there are several factors involved. To draw attention to the fact, as does a quote that I omitted from Apollinarius, he says, to call attention to the fact that the man who does the wrong will often be under great pressure, as for instance that of passion, whereas the man who looks on and applauds will not normally be under any similar pressure, is not at all to diminish the guilt of the doer, but it is to reveal the greater culpability of the applauder. Do you see what he's saying? Is that somebody, you can fall into wrong under the pressure of circumstance and situation, where I have this idea to soften my culpability. I was in the moment. I was this kind of the person who stands at a distance and goes, that's right, wonderful, I'm really glad you're doing that. That's right, you do that. There, it's cold and calculated. But then he goes on and he says, his attitude will very often be the reflection of a settled choice. But there's also the fact that those who condone and applaud the vicious actions of others are actually making a deliberate contribution to the setting up of a public opinion favorable to vice and so to the corruption of an indefinite number of other people. Now you tell me that's not happening in our society. And people who take great pride in, oh, I'm so open and all this, who are actually contributing to a culture that encourages vice. And so I think this is important. Think, no, I don't do that, but I really think it's okay. I think it's wonderful. I think it's fine. Well, you don't escape with that. You see, you don't escape with that. Now, supporters of homosexual unions They claim, you know, they see the text, they see Romans 1, they see this and other texts. They claim that, well, Paul is here, look, he's not condemning all homosexual conduct. Rather, what Paul is condemning here in Romans is coercive or exploitative sex between a man and a boy, or a man and a slave, or a man and a prostitute, or he's condemning homosexual conduct in the context of idol worship. He's not condemning all homosexual conduct, only exploitative forms of homosexual conduct, or homosexual conduct in the context of idol worship. All right, those claims are spurious and obvious grasping at straws. As I just noted, Paul roots his condemnation of homosexual conduct in the creation account. That's what those allusions are for in 20, 25, 26, 27. He's drawing on the creation account and pointing us to it. So he roots the condemnation in the creation account, where mankind was created male and female, the one being created out of the other, only to be rejoined together in the one flesh union of marriage. Out of the other, joined back together, male and female. He's pointing to that. Male and female were God's designed and intended sexual counterparts and complements. Heterosexual relations are natural in the sense they comport with God's intention for and his design of mankind in the beginning, as is obvious from the fit or complementarity of male and female bodies. You see, this didn't escape people's knowledge. It's obvious from the fit of the bodies. It is that natural heterosexual relationship, that which comports with God's intention for mankind from the beginning, it is that natural heterosexual relationship that both men and women abandoned engaging in sexual relations, what Paul calls shameful acts, with their own sex. So it's abundantly clear that the problem of homosexual conduct, according to Paul, and as we saw all through the Old Testament, and as we saw how Jews understood it, but the problem for Paul is that it violates God's will for male-female pairing that was established at creation. And it does so inherently. It does so by the fact it involves sexual activity between the same sex. It does so regardless of the participant's status, relationship, circumstance. It is based on the fact it is male, male, female, female, instead of male, female. That's where it lies. It is not that it is exploitative. It is not that it is coercive. It is not that it is engaged in the context of idol worship. It is because of the sexes of the participants. And you'll see this more. This is confirmed by the fact that female homosexual conduct is included explicitly here. Paul explicitly includes female homosexual conduct in the indictment, and that confirms that Paul's concern is broader than with exploitative sex with a boy, a slave, or a prostitute, and that his concern is broader than homosexual conduct during the worship of idols. And it confirms it because, unlike male homosexual conduct, female homosexual conduct in antiquity did not occur in exploitative relationships or in the context of idol worship. It didn't occur in those situations and contexts. And since lesbianism was not associated in antiquity with exploitative relationships or with worship in an idol context, the fact that Paul condemns it shows that his condemnation is rooted somewhere else, right? He's condemning Female homosexual conduct, which is not exploitative or in the context of idol worship. So Paul clearly is drawing on something else. Well, what could he be drawing on? How about the creation account to which he alludes? How about that? Well, I don't like that answer. I didn't ask if you like the answer. Right? Because what do? We sit at the feet. We want to know, what is he saying? We don't want to say, well, I want to make it say something else. We want to say, what is he saying? Is it not clear what he's saying? Now, that Paul's condemnation includes voluntary homosexual conduct between willing participants, in other words, that it is not restricted to coercive or exploitative forms of homosexual conduct, is further supported by his reference to the men being inflamed with lust for one another. With lust for one another, or desire for one another. Now, the word translated one another, it commonly carries a reciprocal sense, meaning that the thing being discussed is mutual. It goes both ways. Okay? So that one desires one and he returns that desire. It is mutual. They're inflamed with desire for one another. The word normally carries that reciprocal sense. Now, it can be used, that word can be used for some within a group acting on others within a group without a sense of reciprocity or mutuality. For example, in Luke chapter 12, verse 1, it says, they were trampling one another. Well, there it doesn't mean that some trampled others. Those who were trampled got up and trampled those who had trampled them. It doesn't have a sense of reciprocity there. It means some within the group trampled others within the group. They were trampling one another. Okay, it can mean that. But nothing in the context here suggests that atypical meaning. Nothing in the context suggests that. On the contrary, what's Paul doing? Paul is illustrating humanity's headlong plunge into decadence as an expression of God's wrath in giving them over to their fallen desires. So restricting the scope of culpability, you see, making some victims instead of perpetrators, it goes against that purpose. So one would not take the atypical meaning of the word in that context without some indication of doing so. So when he says here they have desire for one another in this context, this is what he means. That it was mutual. Okay, so that means it wasn't coercive and exploitative. So that's just another confirmation of that. Another thing to recognize is that Paul was educated as a Pharisee, and as I showed you, in first century Judaism, based on the Old Testament, condemned all homosexual conduct. First century, Paul's a Pharisee, schooled deeply in Judaism. And first century Judaism unanimously condemned all homosexual conduct. So one would need a really good reason for thinking that Paul was rejecting the typical Jewish understanding. Otherwise, you would assume that Paul is in line with the typical Jewish understanding. And certainly nothing Paul says here points towards such a radical and non-Jewish reinterpretation of God's will. Certainly there's nothing here to say that, well, no, he's bucking all of Judaism. And he is saying that, no, there is forms of homosexual conduct that are fine. Certainly you can't get that out of this. You see, and you would expect some kind of clear indication if that's what he was doing. And his teaching elsewhere, as we'll see in 1 Corinthians 6, 9 and 10, 1 Timothy 1, 8 through 11, confirms Paul's agreement with the traditional view. You see, that all homosexual conduct is sinful. So these attempts to do this, to say, look, Paul's not out, he's not condemning all homosexual conduct. He's only condemning coercive or exploitative forms or homosexual conduct committed in the context of idol worship. That's not right. Now, this evidence that I'm giving you about why that is not right is so clear, is so decisive, that even honest pro-homosexual scholars, people who advocate homosexual unions, scholars who have some facility in the world, you know, in theology, pro-homosexual scholars, they acknowledge that what Paul is saying here is not restricted to coercive or exploitative sexual relationships, or it's not restricted to the context of idol worship. Let me give you some examples. Homosexual Lewis Crompton, he says in his book, Homosexuality and Civilization, published by Harvard University Press, certainly not a right-wing outfit. Okay? Crompton says, according to one interpretation, Paul's words were not directed at bona fide homosexuals in committed relationships, but such a reading, however well-intentioned, and he's very much sympathetic to that reading, he would like that reading to be true because he's homosexual and he's an advocate for the position. But he says, but such a reading, however well-intentioned, seems strained and unhistorical. Nowhere does Paul or any other Jewish writer of this period imply the least acceptance of same-sex relations under any circumstance. The idea that homosexuals might be redeemed by mutual devotion would have been wholly foreign to Paul or any other Jew or early Christian. Bernadette Bruton, who's a self-avowed lesbian, she acknowledged in her influential book, Love Between Women, Early Christian Responses to Female Homoeroticism, Bernadette Bruton says, Romans 1:27, like Leviticus 18:22 and 20:13, condemns all males in male-male relationships, regardless of age, making it unlikely that lack of mutuality or concern for the passive boy were Paul's central concerns. Then she says later, I see Paul as condemning all forms of homoeroticism as the unnatural acts of people who had turned away from God. So you don't have to be somebody like me to see that. You see, I mean, it's pretty clear. It's pretty clear. So you have that recognized there. Now, others have tried to dismiss not only Paul's prohibition of homosexual conduct, but all biblical prohibition of homosexual conduct by claiming that people in the ancient world were unaware of what they call homosexual orientation. You see, I mentioned back when we were looking at Leviticus that I would get to this because I said this is one of the ways that people use to try to get around that, but since I knew I was going to talk about it here, I held that off. So not only do they use this argument to get around what Paul says, but to get around all biblical prohibitions. And the idea and the argument that they make is, listen, people in the ancient world did not know that some people were innately or internally or constitutionally attracted to the same sex. And thus they thought all homosexual conduct was something engaged in by people contrary to their attraction to the opposite sex. They didn't know that some people were really attracted to the same sex. They thought everybody was attracted to the opposite sex, but they knew homosexual conduct went on. And so what it was really a rebellion against your own innate attractions to the opposite sex. Now this is the idea. You see, they were oblivious in the ancient world to the notion that some people were attracted to the same sex. See, homosexual conduct, they claim, was in the ancient world mistakenly viewed as an act of rebellion against these innate or internal desires and proclivities. It was not seen as conduct in fulfillment of these internal or constitutional desires or proclivities. If Moses or Paul, as they would put it, if Moses or Paul had only known, if they had only known that some people are internally or constitutionally attracted to the same sex, they would have exempted those people from the biblical prohibitions. This is nonsense. Okay? This is nonsense. First, the whole premise that people in the ancient world were oblivious to this is wrong. People in the ancient world were well aware that some people were attracted to those of the same sex and that they engaged in homosexual conduct in fulfillment of that attraction. Indeed, they knew that these attractions could be so deeply rooted as to constitute what today is called homosexual orientation. And you've got to wonder, how do they make this argument? How do homosexual advocates who insist that same-sex attraction is a phenomenon set at birth, how can they at the same time insist that the depth of homosexual proclivities went completely unnoticed in ancient societies? On the one hand, they say this is something that's there all the time, right from birth, and you see it, and you see it. But on the other hand, we're going to say nobody in the ancient world knew that. Nobody could see this. So in the first place, you got to wonder how they can make that argument. But you have more examples or more evidence that they did in fact understand this. For example, Aristophanes. Aristophanes was a Greek playwright from around 400 BC. And in Plato, in his writing Symposium, which was around 380 BC, he reports Aristophanes to say of men inclined sexually toward other men that they, quote, are not inclined by nature toward marriage and the procreation of children, yet are compelled to do so by law or custom, yet it suffices for them to live their lives out with one another unmarried. So clearly he recognizes there are some who by nature aren't geared that way and they live their lives out together unmarried in a homosexual relationship. This is hundreds of years BC. And in fact, there were a number of theories in the Greco-Roman world offering a congenital basis for homosexual attraction. See, they had theories. How can we explain this from birth? Well, the very fact that they were trying to construct theories, whatever you think of the theories, and they strike us today as primitive and wrong and all that. But the point is that they were trying to construct theories for the condition from birth. So that shows that they are aware of how deeply rooted it is. And here's how Gagnon summarizes some of their attempts, some of the theories that they had. He says, causation factors included a creation splitting of male-male or female-female binary humans. So somehow they said something's going on in there, there's some kind of splitting, and that's what happens. A particular mix of male and female sperm elements at conception. A chronic disease of the mind or soul influenced directly by biological factors and made hard to resist by socialization. An inherited disease analogous to a mutated gene, sperm ducts leading to the anus, and the particular alignment of heavenly constellations at birth. So do you see that they're recognizing something? They're offering theories for a congenital explanation. You see, so that doesn't that show you that, okay, they were tuned in to the depth of this. Now, William Schodel, who favors homosexual unions. William Schodel remarks, he comments, both Bernadette Bruton and I find problematic the common view that sexual orientation was not recognized in the ancient world. And they find it problematic specifically because of these kinds of things. You see the statements that you see in Plato's Symposium. You see they're trying to construct theories, congenital explanations. William Loder, who's another scholar who supports same-sex unions, he writes in his book, The New Testament and Sexuality. Loder says, Bernadette Bruton, has shown that people in Paul's time did make observations about different sexual orientation, including lifelong orientation. But see, evidence doesn't matter. When you don't want to believe something, evidence doesn't matter. But he says she points to discussions in medicine, astrology, magical practices, and some philosophical discussion. While they're far from the complex theories of modern times and are at best rudimentary, it is not unlikely that Paul would have had some awareness of them. Indeed, I do remember somebody saying, Paul, your great learning is driving you insane. So it's not like Paul was some, you know, mope. Paul's kind of tuned in. Thomas K. Hubbard. He's another pro-homosexual scholar who's written the definitive source book on homosexuality in ancient Greece and Rome. He writes, he says, homosexuality in this era, that is, of the early imperial age of Rome, may have ceased to be merely another practice of personal pleasure and began to be viewed as an essential and central category of personal identity exclusive of and antithetical to heterosexual orientation. So the first thing I want you to see in this idea that, well, what Paul is talking about in all the biblical writers, we can throw it all in the trash because they were unaware of this idea of homosexual orientation. They thought mistakenly that all homosexual conduct was something engaged in by people who were attracted to the opposite sex, but they went ahead and rebelled against that natural sense and engaged in homosexual conduct. That's what they thought. If they'd have known what we know today, they wouldn't have said what they said. Okay? First point is, they were aware of that. So the premise is wrong. Okay? Second, even if one makes the highly unlikely assumption that Paul was unaware of homosexual orientation, and thus he saw homosexual conduct as something that was engaged in only by those of heterosexual orientation, it would not mean that homosexual conduct by those of homosexual orientation escaped his proscription. That wouldn't follow. It wouldn't mean that. There's no reason to think the orientation distinction is relevant to the condemnation. Rather, the condemnation is rooted in the biological sex of the participants based on God's intention at creation. So the orientation thing wouldn't matter, even if you assumed that Paul was unaware of it. As Robert Gagnon says, the bottom line for biblical authors, it did not matter why people willingly engaged in same-sex intercourse, just as it was unnecessary to parse the motivations of those who participated willingly in incest, bestiality, adultery, fornication, or heterosexual prostitution. The question was the act. It was the act that was wrong. And we didn't have to parse the motivations. And that seems clear to me. William Schodel, I mentioned him, another pro-homosexual scholar, I mentioned him a moment ago, he entertains the idea that some support exists in Philo, who's a first century Jewish writer, for thinking that Paul might be speaking in Romans chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, only of same-sex acts performed by those who are by nature heterosexual. He says, you know, you could maybe see some support for making that argument from Philo. But he then dismisses that suggestion. He entertains it. He says, maybe you could make that case from something Philo says, that that's Paul was thinking that way in Romans 1, 26 and 27. He then dismisses that idea and says, but such a phenomenon does not excuse some other forms of same-sex eros in the mind of a person like Philo. It doesn't excuse it. Moreover, we would expect Paul to make that form of the argument more explicit if he intended it. I mean, Paul, if you intend something like that, this is a prescription for being for not being understood. If you're going to say something like that, you're going to have to say it. You can't say what you said and think that you're going to communicate that. Paul's wholesale attack on Greco-Roman culture makes better sense if, like Josephus and Philo, he lumps all forms of same-sex eros together as a mark of Gentile decadence. Martti Nissinen, he's another pro-homosexual scholar, who says in his book, Homoeroticism in the biblical world. He says, Paul does not mention tribades or kenaidoi, that is, female and male persons who were habitually involved in homoerotic relationships. But if he knew about them, and there is every reason to believe he did, it is difficult to think that because of the apparent orientation, he would not have included them in Romans 1, 24 to 27. For him, there is no individual inversion or inclination that would make this conduct less culpable. Presumably, nothing would have made Paul approve homoerotic behavior. That is right. Now, why is that? It is because God has revealed it. Paul is a Jewish scholar. He knows the Old Testament. He knows what God has said. And the Spirit who inspired him certainly knows what God has said. Bernadette Bruton, the lesbian who is obviously pro-homosexual here. Did I cut off the bottom? I guess I did. Okay. Thus, both arguments fall short that Paul condemns only heterosexuals committing homosexual acts and not homosexuals per se, and that the distinction between sexual orientation and sexual acts would have made no sense to him. Both of those arguments fail. He would have been well aware of the distinction, you see, and he's condemning all homosexual conduct anyway. It says Paul could have believed that tribades, the actual female, the active female partners in a female homosexual bond, the ancient kenaidoi, the passive male partners in a male homosexual bond, and other sexually unorthodox persons were born that way and yet still condemn them as unnatural and shameful. Then she says, I see Paul as condemning all forms of homoeroticism as the unnatural acts of people who had turned away from God. I read that quote to you before from her. And that's right. So that's how Paul sees it. You see, it is rebellion against the creation order. And so it doesn't matter. It's the question of male, female. That's what's at play. So that's a pro-homosexual cause. So those are two things. First is the premise is wrong. Second is, even if Paul was unaware of this, it wouldn't matter. It would still come within his proscription. Third, if sexual orientation, if that's the critical distinction in the acceptability of homosexual conduct, and if it was unknown to mankind until recently that some people are oriented toward the same sex, why would God, who knows everything, why would he inspire Paul or anybody else to write what would necessarily, because the idea is we didn't know about it until recently, why would he inspire Paul to write what would necessarily be misunderstood to condemn things of which God approves? Do you follow that? If the idea is, listen, they didn't know about orientation. Well, God knew. God knew. So why would God inspire someone to say something that because of the alleged ignorance of orientation would necessarily be understood to condemn all forms of homosexual conduct when in fact the idea is that, well, God approved of some. Well, then why did he say something that would be understood as him disapproving? So you can't use that with God. You cannot use that idea with God. Whatever one makes of the human element in Scripture, and there is a human element, that God works through people's personalities and training and all that kind of thing. That's why you can see differences in writing. There's a human element, but you cannot deny the divine element, because to deny the divine element, that's the essence of Scripture, that Scripture is what? God breathed. You see, it is exactly what God wanted written. Now finally, and this is very important, and if the bell rings, I'm going to keep talking. Because this is important, okay? Finally, on this idea, orientation allows us to dispatch all of the Bible's condemnation of homosexual conduct. The morality of a behavior is not determined by whether the desire to engage in that behavior is innate or constitutional or internal. The morality of a behavior is not determined by whether the desire to engage in it is innate. The depth of a desire and the fact that one would prefer not to have that desire, that does not mean it is God's will for one to act on that desire. Greed, pride, sexual lust, envy, jealousy, selfishness are urges that we do not choose to experience, but we experience. They are part of who we are as fallen human beings. And the fact they are innate, internal, deep, does not sanctify them. It does not sanctify them. Rather, their desires and impulses to which Christ calls us not to yield. Isn't that right? They are desires and impulses that are there. I wish I didn't have them. I don't want them. I fight them. And the fact they're deep in the night, this kind of doesn't mean, okay, well, I just roll with it, and that makes it okay. No, those are things to which Christ calls us not to yield. We honor Christ in our struggle against them, not in justifying our wallowing in them. Hear me. This is important. I love what Gagnon says about this. Humans are not robots or mere animals. Their choices are not limited to enslaving impulses of the flesh. God's moral will cannot be held hostage to human sexual libidos. Jesus, not any alleged constitutional predisposition, is Lord. Now the church ought to say amen. You see, this is the truth. So all of it, when you say, well, this is deep down, I don't doubt that it's deep down. But let me tell you what's deep down in me that I would like to be rid of. And that doesn't say, well, it's deep, it's part of who I am. As far as I can remember, I've been a selfish pig. What does that mean? That means it's okay? No, do you see that that doesn't determine? Christ calls us to put to death these kinds of things that we might glorify Him. Okay, there's another argument made here. I know the bell's going to ring, and I suspect I'll just pick up with this one at the end, but I'll talk till the bell rings because I've got you captive. Okay. Okay. He's messing with me. Thanks for coming.